Good morning, everyone, and good afternoon to our global sangha. I've been reading a book called The Raft Is Not the Shore, which is a dialogue between Thich Nhat Hanh and the Jesuit priest Daniel Berrigan. This beautiful conversation between these two great spiritual leaders and two people who we know have really embodied the practice, because in their work to relieve suffering in the world, and particularly for both of them in their anti-war activism, both of them suffered personal great hardship for their work, and it didn't stop them continuing to work, and it didn't stop them being joyful. So I think of them as really courageous people, and I want to talk about fear today as one of the obstacles to having a joyful life. And there was one sentence in the conversation between the two of them where Daniel Berrigan said, there is a hint that actuality is not as fearful as fear itself. There is a hint that actuality is not as fearful as fear itself. And this is often how the practice works for me, the teachings work. I just hear a sentence. You know, I might have been reading 800 sentences, and then one particular sentence jumps out and kind of captures my imagination. And so that's what I've been thinking about. Not just the part about as bad as we fear that they are, that kind of thought, but the fact that he says there is a hint. It's like we are given this message repeatedly that our fear is worse than the things that we fear. Our fear of them is worse than the things themselves, and there is a hint of that in our daily life that we can look for. So it's thinking about the ways in which we experience fear. And one way is that we fear something bad will happen. And so when we use the word bad and good in Buddhism, we're using it in a conventional sense, like what we conventionally think of as bad. But Buddhism doesn't say that anything is actually bad or anything is actually good. Things that are conventionally bad often turn out to make us much stronger people. So in that sense, they're actually good. And sometimes things that appear bad turn out not to be bad just because it changes the course of our day or of our life, and the directional change turns out to be something that we are able to be very creative with. And the same with good. Things that sometimes are conventionally good don't turn out to really be that good. I was thinking a little of how sometimes parents want everything to be so good for their children that they don't allow their children to experience hardship or challenge. And that's the sort of example we have of sometimes... you're welcome to come in. Sometimes we have probably encountered children who are not that happy because they haven't really been challenged in their life. They get what they want too much. They get too much good. And so the good turns out to actually be bad. So When we're talking about fear and we talk about when bad things happen, I'm using the word that way, in the conventional sense of bad, but not necessarily actually in the very big picture bad. It may be just conventionally bad. So one way that we work with fear is we have the thought something bad will happen, and we worry about that bad thing happening, and then it doesn't happen. I think all of us have had that happen many times. We can think of all sorts of examples. You could probably think of one just right now. That either it's something that you can think of about yourself, or a common kind of thing that happens for people, like getting a medical test and you're waiting for the result. That's a pretty common one. Worrying that it will be bad and it turns out not to be bad. So that's one way in which we experience fear. And another is worrying that something bad will happen, or maybe even has happened. We're worrying that something bad has already happened or will happen, and then it turns out that it isn't quite as bad as we thought. That happens a lot too. The thing that we're worried about does kind of happen, but it's not as bad as we thought. So there is a diagnosis, it's not quite as bad as we thought, but it is a diagnosis, for example. And then sometimes we worry that something bad will happen, and it does happen just as we kind of worried that it would, but we discover that we coped with it better than we imagined. So the bad thing did happen just as we worried it would, but we actually coped with it quite well. So that's another way in which these are sort of examples of this idea of hint. Basically, I'm giving you examples of the hint that our fear is worse than actuality. So the first is we fear something bad and it just doesn't happen. The second is that we fear something bad and it does happen, but it's not as bad as we thought. The third could be that something bad happens, it is as bad as we thought, but we cope with it quite well. And then sometimes something bad happens, it's really bad, and we don't cope with it very well. And of course, that's very sad, very painful. And that happens to people, of course, a lot. Bad things happen to them, and they don't cope with it very well. And the reason is a combination of the thing itself that happened, but it's very much influenced by what their mind does with it. So it's not very often really, I would say in the most purest sense, it never is just the event itself. It's always the event combined with how our mind interacts with it. The five skandhas, form, sensation, perception, mental reaction, and consciousness. The first one, form, is kind of like the things in the world, the things we interact with, the phenomena in the world. But the other four of the skandhas are to do with our perceptions and our interpretation of our experience. So one practice I do a lot is noticing. First of all, it's just good to notice when we've got fear. Just simply that. That's very good to notice that we might be driving along and we're imagining something and we're feeling a little fearful about it. And fear in the wider sense of the word, it could be just a little bit of worry. It could be kind of that sort of repeating over and over, rehearsing in our mind what we're going to say, what we're going to do to try and mitigate things. And of course, it can be all the way through to the sort of heart pounding and breath being very shallow and palms getting sweaty. And like insomnia, people lying in bed thinking about things. So the first thing for us as practitioners is just to become very aware of how fear is manifesting in our mind. can be very subtle little fears. I used to have a lot of fear about being late. It wasn't that subtle, it was quite loud actually. I worried quite a lot about being late. And, you know, just observing that for years and years and years, I'm much better at not worrying about being late now. I hardly ever am late, but I don't worry about it. I'm just pretty punctual and I don't worry about it. So it's very good. That feels healthy. So sometimes the fears are just tiny little things like that. Everyone has different fears. They can generally be categorized in fairly common ways, fears of what people think. In the end, all of our fears are to do with some kind of sense of annihilation, some kind of fear of death in the widest sense of that word, of identifying with the self and feeling like it's going to be threatened, whatever this sense of who we are is, the identity we have with it, that is being threatened in some way. And we often extend that sense of who we are to our family, often our biological family. So we can equally feel worry and fear for our biological family and other people we identify strongly with. So one thing that I do is notice that I have fear. Then I notice what types of thoughts I'm imagining. And then I practice actually imagining very positive ways of dealing with difficult situations. I do this a lot. I think I do this a lot because all of us have this tendency of imagining in our minds something happening that's not ideal in the conventional sense, and then imagining how we'll respond to it. And it's almost a type of self-hypnosis that we convince ourselves that we won't manage very well. People do that a great deal. So one thing that we can do is just practitioners kind of recognizing our true nature and the beauty of our Buddha nature is to imagine ourselves managing something difficult actually really well. It's just a really good practice. If you haven't done that very much, I encourage you to try it out. Just imagine yourself handling a really difficult situation really well. No big deal. Like not egocentric in an egocentric way, just in a in a way I think that's a respecting ourselves as practitioners. We can respect ourselves as practitioners that we can handle difficult things, and in a way that confirms the power of the teachings, that they are wise teachings. So fear in general is a kind of forward looking. And one of the conversations in this book between Thich Nhat Hanh and Daniel Berrigan is how fear, I mean, the book isn't particularly about fear, it's just one little spot in the book. But in that little spot, they talk about how people sacrifice the present they sacrifice the beauty and the abundance of the present to try and secure an abundant future. So they have this image that the future is not going to be as good as they want it to be. So that's the fear. The future will not be as good as I want it to be. And leaning into that fear that the future won't be as good as I want it to be, they're sacrificing what they have right in front of them. They're failing to appreciate what's right here, right now, in their fear. And in fact, will even destroy and harm what's right in front of them to try and guarantee a secure future. And they actually speak about that being the basic dynamic of war. That is the basic dynamic of war. Leaning very far into a type of future that you want to secure. And in leaning into that future that you want to secure, you destroy things in the present. And Thich Nhat Hanh gives that example. I think it was some general that said, some American general that said, you need to bomb the village to save the village. It's so clear what a tragically deluded thought that is. But in fact, that is what a lot of people do a lot of the time. On a less dramatic way. damage the present to try and secure a non-fearful future. So fear is leaning into the future at the expense of the present. And really what's a wholesome way is to plan a little bit for the future, because we do need to plan a little bit to try and, you know, because we have a body, so we do need to plan a little bit for the future. You know, that we've got a water bottle if we're going hiking or something like that. But we don't have to spend a lot of time thinking about a water bottle to take with us hiking. We only just need to think about a little bit. We don't need to think about it a lot. So we can still be taking care of the future that, of course, will just be the present when it's happening. But we can do that. Just don't need to spend a lot of time doing it. We spend too much time doing it. So there's a koan I'd like to read out from The Gateless Barrier, the Mumonkan. Case 28, Luong Tan, renowned far and wide. So I'll read the whole koan, but there's a particular bit that I just really like. Taishan visited Luong Tan and questioned him sincerely far into the night. It grew late and Luong Tan said, "Why don't you retire?" Taishan made his bows and lifted the blinds to withdraw, but was met by darkness. Turning back, he said, "It is dark outside." Luong Tan lit a paper candle and handed it to Taishan. Taishan was about to take it when Luong Tan blew it out. At this, Taishan had sudden realization and made bows. Luong Tan said, "What truth did you discern?" Taishan said, "From now on, I will not doubt the words of an old priest who is renowned everywhere under the sun." The next day, Luong Tan took the high seat before his assembly and said, "I see a brave fellow among you monks. His fangs are like a sword tree. His mouth is like a blood bowl. Give him a blow and he won't turn his head. Someday he will climb the highest peak and establish our way there." Taishan brought his notes on the Diamond Sutra before the Dharma Hall and held up a torch, saying, "Even though you have exhausted the abstruse doctrines, it is like placing a hair in vast space. Even though you have learned all the secrets of the world, it is like letting a single drop of water fall into an enormous valley." And he burned up all his notes. Then, making his bows, he took leave of his teacher. This is a very well-known case. Taishan is one of the great teachers of China. And so the part about this that this I particularly is strong for me is that Taishan has had this dialogue with this great teacher and then is about to leave. And as he sort of opens the door and looks out, it's dark. It's dark. I think all of us know that feeling of what it's like to go into the dark. We just had our electricity go out down in Goongarra, and there's no lights around, so there's no other people around. So when there's no electricity in the middle of the night, it's just dark, and the moon wasn't up. It was really dark. And there's just that feeling of it's like, you know, you get a little vigilant. It's in our evolution to be slightly scared of the dark. So Taishan is about to go out. He's probably somewhere where it's kind of warm and there's candlelight and they've probably had tea. And now he's going to step out into the dark. And Luong Tan gives him a candle. So then there's that sense of like, "Oh, I'm going to be all right. I've got my candle." And as he's about to step out, the candle is blown out. and something happens for him in that moment, his fear all drops away. It doesn't say that in the case, but when someone has great realization, part of great realization is a dropping away of a sense of a separate self. And when we don't have a strong sense of a separate self, we don't have strong fear. The stronger our identity is as a separate entity, the stronger our fear. So in that moment, his fear of the dark dropped away and he had great realization. And the dark here isn't just referring to the literal darkness. It's a fear of that sense of annihilation, of not existing, of extinction, fear of extinction. So he loses that fear in that moment. And we have benefited from that for centuries afterwards. So that can be for us something to really contemplate. Can we practice not identifying with this individual self, but instead kind of identifying with the whole world, the whole universe, seeing the whole lot as ourself, wanting everyone and everything to be well, for everything to be safe and to be at ease, and for all conflicts to dissolve? Can we just walk about in our life with that kind of feeling in our mind? We don't have to be thinking it as an active thought, but have that sense in our whole being of loving everything, wanting it all to be well, having no one that we dislike, having no one that we are judging harshly. We can have people that we disagree with, but not have that actual animosity towards in any way. Always feeling compassion towards them, even if they're doing terrible things. Can we just function that way? And if we function that way, and more that way, we become much less fearful, because there's nothing to protect. Or what there is to protect is just that one side of the truth. It's just the form side of the teachings. It's not the empty side of the teachings, so to speak. So it's not quite so compelling. There's another story that goes with this koan. And this is about before Taishan had this dialogue. He had this other dialogue. Before Taishan crossed the barrier from his native province, his mind burned and his mouth sputtered. Full of arrogance, he went south to exterminate the doctrine of the special transmission outside the sutras. So this is an old story about in the north of China, they were very scholarly, and in the south of China, they were into sort of direct realization. It's kind of a trope that can be useful, but it's, as long as we don't take it too seriously, it's too true. So he was from the north, full of arrogance, he was going to the south. When he reached the road to Li Chau, he sought to buy refreshments from an old woman. The old woman said, "Your reverence, what sort of literature do you have there in your cart?" Taishan said, "Notes and commentaries on the Diamond Sutra." The old woman said, "I hear the Diamond Sutra says, past mind cannot be grasped, present mind cannot be grasped, future mind cannot be grasped. Which mind does your reverence intend to refresh?" Taishan was dumbfounded and unable to answer. He did not expire completely under her words. However, but asked, "Is there a teacher of Zen Buddhism in this neighbourhood?" The old woman said, "The priest Lung Tan is about half a mile from here." Arriving at Lung Tan's place, Taishan was utterly defeated. His earlier words certainly did not match his later ones. Lung Tan disgraced himself in his compassion for his son. Finding a bit of live coal in the other, he took up muddy water and drenched him, destroying everything at once. Viewing the matter dispassionately, you can see it was all a farce. So I love this. And imagine that you're this great scholar, and then you meet this old woman and ask for tea, and she says, past mind cannot be grasped, present mind cannot be grasped, future mind cannot be grasped. Which mind does your reverence intend to refresh? He can't think of anything to say. He's dumbstruck. But he does not expire completely under her words. One thing that's just slightly sad, though, is that he asks, is there a teacher of Zen Buddhism in this neighbourhood? And wouldn't it have been lovely if she had said, my temple is up on the hill, I will be back later. But of course, in that time, women weren't able to be Zen masters, and so instead she tells him where the Zen master is. There's one other koan in the hidden lamp. One day, when Master Jiaozhou Kongshen was outside the monastery, he saw an old woman hoeing a field. He asked her, what would you do if you suddenly met a fierce tiger? She replied, nothing in this world frightens me, and turned back to her hoeing. Jiaozhou roared like a tiger. She roared back at him. Jiaozhou said, there's still this. I often think of koans like this and think, oh, could I really be someone that could say, I'm not afraid of anything? I think we should hold ourselves to that kind of standard. Not to say, I haven't reached that standard, I'm so lame, not like that, but I'm going to practice to be like that. I want to be like that, in a kind of joyful way. I want to be a fearless person. No matter what comes up, I'll be able to respond appropriately and not be confused by fear. Not contract. Fear is very contracting. Sort of contract inwards. Can't think clearly when we've got fear. So could we keep ourselves expansive even in a very difficult situation? And you know, just hold that as a direction for us to go in. Not to forcefully try and make it happen, but just to hold it there as a possibility that it's something that we're entitled to as much as anybody else. Maybe entitled is a bit, maybe not the best word, but we're not different to any of the great masters of history if we practice sincerely, day in, day out, moment in, moment out. We can have that kind of courage. I think that's all. I'll just turn the recording off and see if there's any questions.